start by clearing a stale breath. Please take three long breaths. Oh. The verses of the Eight Noble Auspices. Taji jo ji ji na shu ba yi san ge ju dan ge du ba be zo gu la cha sa da cha zhe xi shu zhe me ge po zhe den dun ru gong jiang be ge pe ge zha pe dang ba gu la gong pa ge jie zha pa qian long po Darpa Tilda Beldani Tim Chen Tom Che Lagung Jabe Itim Zepa Zera Jabe Tim Tom Tu Pe Tashi Pepe Dewa Shepa Gyala Chasalo Jamajunu Belden Dorje Genre Ze Wang Gombo Jambe Sai Nibo Dipa Number Se Namge Nibo. Jaji Belgi Jo Janjo Samba Gela Chaselo
That's it. Chenai Mingarangzo, chiranamazom nyumanga du tedu inle be ta kusenge mangshu zere be nyumanga du tedu kain san be peshe be pume nye le meshe be lume me nye pume she be bang me nye sege tedu jobu ni do le ngarang zu kanga ba mi zu zangma zom be sengi singi ni le jila denjong gu kholyo nangden chising nangsing kechi ba me be Legi layo, Korea, Dodoka, Sumer, Chising, Nansing, Yuva, Chichik of Sing Sing, Nang Be, Lumba Sing Sing, Pama Buru Sing Sing, Gangalo Jimbe, Mimages and Trekkuk Shivanja, Gage Pame Bodun, Legi layo, Korea, Dodoka, Yins Sumer. Tea Yimba Red, the other tea of the Gangalo, Chicherans of Lagat Singers of Bay, Tama, the Social Lagat Bay. We dreamed the Jenny Kadaka was and chair. So the boo put yore. There was under yore. Today, you make up the letter, me children, say, Talk Jim Mulam Gibe, Gangalong, as children, and as an hour, Sandu Zomni, two seven niggers of Bay Yams along, Sijun, and Mulam so at the Jimmy. Gave us some which is some with those.
And in these times of these times of the five degenerations, the situation is so difficult. There's so much turmoil. Making an effort to come and do Dharma and to do it so well in these times is really wonderful. There's an old Tibetan saying, outside. Gonda. There's a four-line verse in the Dorje Trolo teachings. Outwardly, everything is chaos. Inwardly, everything is chaos. Even in the family, there's chaos. And so it's really like that. And right now. And so in that situation, then Rinpoche knows all of you, you have to work so hard, and then on top of that, to make the effort to come and do Dharma, to practice, it's really special.
Yang Chujag, Chujag, Chisum design, Duba taking, Yinsum, Chujag, Chisum design, Duba in, Chisum design, the Jambayan. Team with Dubby, Serasa Walsh in the Nangasin, the Kurangs of Pur Gab.
The present Dalai Lama, the 14th Dalai Lama, is also known as the emanation of the King Chisum Desen. And King Chisum Desen is emanation of Manjushri. And so, because of that, his soulless. Incredible his manifestation of benefiting being today spread all over the world and that magnificence at the same time the fourth school of Tibetan Buddhism great Tibetan spiritual masters and their students and some come like as a unconventional hidden masters. So various masters, they all came in this world and spreading the Buddha Dharma. And what a wonderful occasion that is,
Rinpoche-san. So when the Gazum, the Belanga, Mangbusan, Lunga, Dibuch, Shibsa, you are the Yinja Dibuting Sava me, Digwesa, you are the Digwal Mishakwa, Digwal Yundan, May and Shakweta with Digway Yun, Yin Sunger, teacher to Minga Kasang, Mangus Yogangi, you get the Yabo Sum. Thinking made you about the Suyins and the Guru Gardin Zandri, till the two Jun to Soa and Arazu, Nagung Yabia, Damnata, Legacy and Yang Yishibusha, and the Mary.
And so there are so many different traditions of the Dharma that were held in Tibet and have now spread around the world, the Nyingma tradition, the Kagyu tradition, the Sakya tradition, and the Gelug tradition. And here, Chögyam Rinpoche has created this center and brought us all together, and we've received the teachings that we've received the last week or so. It's the point of the teachings, whatever teachings they are, is to purify our obscurations and to purify the obscurations we've accumulated through negative actions, not just from this lifetime, but for many, many, many lifetimes. Even in this lifetime, we might feel we've been very good, but in countless lifetimes, we must have disrespected bodhisattvas or done all sorts of things we didn't even know we did. And so in order to purify, and it's said in the teachings, negative actions or negative karma has no good qualities except for one. If you confess it, it can be purified. And so confession practice, and particularly the practice of the 100-syllable mantra, as Rinpoche has said in the past, is so important to do the 100-syllable mantra of Vajrasattva, to practice the 100-syllable mantra of Vajrasattva, and also especially to do the practice of Guru Padmasambhava, because his blessings and the power of his practices of practicing him, praying to him, doing the practices associated with Guru Padmasambhava are so swift and so powerful in these degenerate times. And of course, all of you are busy. You have to work, you have to face a lot of difficulties in your lives, so you need to really hit the key point with your practice. And so if you can remember those, just do those two practices, it can be enough. And then, of course, you've received the Dzogchen teachings now, so you're extremely fortunate for that to have happened. But whatever teachings you practice, whether it's the very high teaching like the Dzogchen teaching, or whether you're doing your Vajrasattva practice, whatever teaching you practice, it said the 84,000 teachings of the Buddha were taught for only one purpose, to subdue your own neurotic mind. So if that's what you're doing with your practice, that's hitting the point. And if that's not what you're doing with your practice, then you need to think about it.
There's a quotation that 84,000 teachings of Buddha is meant for only one purpose, and that one purpose is to subdue one's afflictive emotion and neurotic mind. There is no other purpose than that for this teaching of the 84,000.
Lübe imbe rile çeburdu nga be mawa mamang jidacu simbe rangyu kone jiridu bebe ne jusina telesel sesung yari bodu rimje kapdu tadu sangbu yari lü çö çekumu yari nangen yari şugen tözü yari ta tisan tözü be nima du tözü ne be nyuru du zubruçin mitemje mugu şidan dörce şiedan çödü kanıda be nyomu du rahruçin zan Redwell duty cover cabada, so to just some may be to yori. Yinja then made sublime china. Shoga, it was the Nabodland tunes you did and cheek. Ungomi choosing any tunes you get in number the yamsan and tinia china. Then I may invaded you sub the tea and then dress up the duma. Tinday jeecher. Then it is a shabby tony rangs same the jumps with you, didn't send yet on by yinsen. Same conditions do Rishana. Same the meat during the young donkey, then the same 2 years are married. The Michel is the yard. She did go and a rang you rang it on rang the same deal in your mom would be
So Padre Rinpoche used to say, hide your body in the mountains, hide your speech by remaining silent, hide your mind by leaving it in its natural state. That is the meaning of hidden yogi. And of course, Padre Rinpoche was living in a very different time and place. And of course, that's true. It'd be great if we could do that. But Padre Rinpoche was living in a very different time and place. It's difficult for us to go live alone in the mountains like that. We have a different lifestyle that we're really stuck with. Nonetheless, we can certainly get up early in the morning and practice. And it's really important to do that. If you get up early in the morning and practice, and then there's another teaching of the Buddha, Rangi Semni Yonso Do Dine Sangi Tempayin.
Let me insert just one word in that. Rinpoche said that during Paro Rinpoche's time, it was a different time. It was today, people are so busy. Of course, people have to make their living, but like we don't even have the time to eat food. So talking about, you know, being in a mountain is really hard. Everyone is rushing all the time. So therefore, one has to get up early in the morning and do the practice, generate the bodhicitta mind, and go on in that.
So, yes, and Rinpoche was saying, and the point of all the practices is, again, this one verse from the teachings of the Buddha, subdue your mind completely. That is the teaching of the Buddha. So, of course, it's naturally the way of ordinary human beings is to look outside, to see everybody's faults, to look at everyone else's faults and not at your own faults. But the essence of the Dharma is to look at your own faults.
And Rinpoche really stressed this so many times during these last few days of teaching, look at the fault. He said, unless we look at our own fault, there is no way we can find peace. As we talk about world peace, but world peace is not going to happen by criticizing, judgment, that kind of mindset, always looking at others' fault. You know, even one has a fault like a mountain, one doesn't see that. And others' tiny little fault, we are able to see that. And those are the mistakes that we really have to work with, find, see one's own fault, look at one's own fault, then there is possibility we can subdue their mind and there can be peace after that.
And Rinpoche is saying this admonition not to look at the faults of others but to see your own faults, you really have to take it in every direction, whether you're dealing with other people, whether you're talking or thinking about other Dharma centers, other lamas,
other religions. Philosophy, other religion. Do not criticize. Do not criticize other schools, sects, whether it's others or within Tibetan Buddhism itself, Nyingma, Kagyu, Sakya, Gelug. Do not make criticism of that.
No. And so Rinpoche said, for example, in Tibet, there were both Buddhists and Bonpos. In India, there were the Buddhist tradition and the non-Buddhist Hindu traditions. In China, you had the Buddhist tradition and the Taoist traditions. There will always be these other traditions, but you just leave it. You just don't need to get involved in criticizing conflict. You turn your mind inward, and the point is to look at your own faults and to bring your practice into yourself. So what you should be spending your energy doing is getting up early in the morning and doing your practice. And it will help you if you think about the next life. We're constantly concerned about this life. Not only major concerns or problems with this life, but constantly one little concern after another. We come home from work and there's this to do, there's that to do, there's this little thing to do. But instead, if you think about this life won't last very long, but another will come, and we don't know where we're going to be reborn. Anywhere in the six realms. If we were reborn in the hell realms, what would that be like? If we were reborn in the hungry ghost realms, what would that be like? If we were reborn as an animal, what would that be like? If we were reborn in the demigods' realms or in a human realm, but not with the good fortune that we have in this life, what would that be like in the demigods or even in the gods' realms? Still, we wouldn't have the opportunity we have now to practice the Dharma. We've received such profound teachings, and one should think, now I've received these profound teachings, I have this precious opportunity in this short life to really put them to good use. And to really benefit myself, not just for this life, for the future life. And if you think like that, then it'll be much easier to set aside all these little distractions.
I think what the point again Rinpoche is making is about the looking at one's fault. Because we all want happiness, whether it's this life or the next life or whatever life that may be. But unless we work with the fault of our own mind, we can never achieve the result which we want happiness. I think that's what is really trying to stress again and again and again. First work with one mind. Earlier, during the teaching he gave, if you don't look at the fault, how can you subdue your mind, tame the afflictive emotion? And the next word he said, if you couldn't subdue the afflictive emotion, how can you possibly see the nature of enlightened mind?
Tamu kartuji de chile modik singin de sanje de be muni tik be ne modik shabarje ning be mi shamdik de du yor man ju chig mar thonzu la de le ko khala dong ten nang ba sanje chig jil khadum ye ji be na gidu bu jil ji bu thambe du be khaje yor sanje jil gu bu ji bu thambe khaje yor ning me du ji bu ze ten thonzu khadang na khamsum simje se le dik shwa chenju se man nam la gu ba de thami dik jin sha ba thole sha sum yor chig ji khadang na be rangi lenga saro ma da bi penji yue za mi ganga lo jeb se sam te ba che rangi lama ti dang chu lu thai ne ti rang su su ma ji xian le nie che ma na nie che ma nie ma son rang chu lu di be chu gu lama dang rang chu ji sab san che xian le ka ma dang xian ne ten ne be ya wo yo re
ben Rinpoche is also saying that we should not criticize like, oh, that's, you know, supposing one is Nyingma, oh, that's Giluk not good, that's Kagyu not good, that's Sakya not good, that's Giluk not good. That kind of sectarian basis, sectarianism, including to other religions such as like during Buddha's time, Hinduism was the main religion. There was Buddhism and Hinduism, and even Buddha himself said, you should not criticize Hinduism, because actually the Hinduism in Tibetan is called mutek. Mu means kind of like below, tek means supporting, because if you really look, all of those philosophy kind of help each other for us to enhance and be a better person. And so therefore, even someone doesn't really show the ultimate nature, but there are so many other things which can be supportive. So therefore, it's not good to be sectarianism, fundamentalism, fanaticism, and those are not good at all. We should kind of look in a positive way, have a pure vision. That is important, particularly in the Dharma, whether it's within the Giluk, there are great lamas in Latin being bodhisattvas, and within Kagyu, and within Sakya, and within Nyingma, all of those tradition holds great in Latin beings. So we should always maintain a pure vision, not have a criticism mind and judgmental mind. But at the same time, one's own tradition and one's own lama, the teaching which is given, you hold it, you practice that, you make it the best to realize that, so that one doesn't have to always doubt, should I go there, should I go there, hear a little bit here, a little bit there, always like undecided. Shouldn't be that. You need to focus to your lama, focus to your practice one-pointedly, then you will succeed.
Me jun la mada was a rang, nyomo tungadik, kande chan jun di tesn, nyomo tungadi, yanga jun the tongsona, tishi wadugri. She was in sun and candy missum del kayu, sendu sambasi, rang a jun the tongni, jun 666, rang a jun the honey, ten shedi neduzan, ting and yamlin neduzan, gibutambas, tabulam the rosatiri. Rang a jun the madam, me jun jangi dena. Rangyun rangitung wa chingyul, shangyun dandun wa chingyul, samyan dukdub shi wa chingyul, samsang tingdaga wa chingyul, sik di shi di bu nyamsa lani duyuar. Di rangitung di jangla yang te, rangitung dandun midi shedi rujji, shedi ma ziru. Shedi chingsu na, hantri misun samalo gayung di mado tila niba zan shingmar. Rangyun hadung na ta gangalo be, ngarjaya di yoyosu bu chingyul, misun zan su kanka jimar. Di rangyun di rangitung wa chingyul. Nyamling kashan, it's in George and Marang Yang Luxero. Tea into them, less of some now with those.
So, what is the point of looking at your own faults? If you look at your own faults, then you pacify your own mind. If you can look at your own faults, then you'll find peace. Instead of feeding your own neurosis, you'll be able to get rid of it. And that's the path to liberation. That's
how one is, one way to become a bodhisattva is looking at one's fault. Yeah.
No. And if you see others' faults, you're just going to stir up your mind. So, and Rinpoche quoted again from Dujin Rinpoche's prayer, bless me to have no desire to see the other faults of others. Bless me to see my own faults. And there were two other lines, you remember Rinpoche?
Please bless me so that I can subdue my neurotic, afflictive emotions. And Samsung Kungle Shabar Chingalo, please bless me so that the pure, kind, good heart can arise from the depth of my heart.
And so, instead of looking at your own faults and thinking like that, you just hold on to your pride, then it poisons everything. No one can get along with someone with pride.
Rinpoche is saying, therefore, when a person, when we look at our own fault, then the minds get pacified, the mind get in peace, and then at that time, humans, non-humans, spirit, everyone will love you because you have no enemy, you know. So therefore, I think what Rinpoche is also meaning that we can come out of our loneliness, like when we have that kind of mindset, when you have that peace established in your mind, because once we have the pride and neurosis, then nobody likes us. There is no peace. And he's mentioning the way to become a bodhisattva, who is loved by everyone, is the first by looking at one's fault. Then by looking at one's fault, then it will lead one to become a bodhisattva.
And then Rinpoche also added, so with that attitude, it's very important to train your mind in that way, and it's also important to practice the profound instructions that you've received. And so you get up early in the morning, you do your practice, and then your lifestyle is important, the choices you make about your lifestyle. Of course, you have to go out and work, take care of the necessities of life. But if you, once you have enough, then you should be satisfied. And in particular, you also have this time when you come home after work. And if you have, of course, you'll have some things to do. You may need to pay your bills or do some important things. But if you take too much interest in all the different goings on that are going on throughout the world and this and that, then you'll be so busy and your time will be used up and you'll fall asleep and you won't do your practice. So it'll be impossible for you to practice. So come home, take care of just what you need to do, and then put your energy into your practice.
Which is particularly mentioning about television and internet, you know, that will be the main poison to your practice. You will get so distracted. So therefore, only whatever you need to do it, like you're paying bills or whatever you have to do for, you have no choice. But more than that, if one get into that habit, then it will take away your meditation totally, the biggest obstacle to your practice. So therefore, really try to limit being distracted with the gadgets.
Then now that young children, then they should get young or long. Luna sim the hurt, every shore, young lama the lamasang, the meta was the lama that is so I step. So them the ranking on to them, gang on to them, mushit again, mushit. Jirim zungwe jirim, zorim gungwe zorim, shine gungwe shine. So, that is what in it, any? So, the Kanolo young woman who united in the young Kansas Chibuchula do the Dugulame Dungi sings a Lama took the Kunazi Kamjung the Yung Chubuku Jug to Sigidu. Amjo the Yung Jump the Million Washing a Quay Quaka Sigidu. That is the Tokza Shibu to Masam say, Lerida. That here some shifts down the tea, teacher to river. Guya quok, Taktaka, dang. Sensing among the sham the Yushan, Yamlin Dilchana, then the getting number the Tonda Shamachuri. Tim when you were Yamlin Dilitan, Hadi Tonda Shamuji, the Ali Yamlin Yusha, some such and such a niche, new Shazan, then Namdo could give you a young do it and the Dugo's money way of it. Teach you your Juma was just some don't worry.
First you go, then I was up.
So Rinpoche is saying, okay, so you get up early in the morning and then Lula sem la le. So you get up and
man la lune sem. Nyesin na sem de ya tambu yo de chi le ga tem jam de yusha. Chinang le ga cha ge yone che ge kambu yusha. Ten yegi na le du dan le ge sam de me cha ten be le sem ga lo de cha ni sa de ni nya ni de me ko le sha ko ni nyam ni chi ji tin de me wa cha. Ti cha na ten ga rang du nyam ni cha ba lo. Nyomong
So you get up first thing in the morning, you sit straight, and there's an old phrase, you rest the body in the bed, you rest the mind in the body, and then you leave the mind to relax and to be spacious. But that doesn't mean that you're just kind of like this or like that. You saw, I don't really need to explain, even without words, you understood Rinpoche. Relaxed, and Rinpoche is also emphasizing, you of course you need to keep a good posture, but relaxed, open, easy at the same time. You also need to discipline your mind. If while you're doing your practice, you're already thinking about this and that, what you're going to do during the day, it won't happen. You can practice forever for your whole life, hours and hours every day, but if you let yourself, your mind just run wild with all the affairs of your life while it happens, it's not going to happen. So you have to do, you just make a boundary, you drop it, and...
otherwise one can become a slave on one's concept, conceptual, for the rest of one's life.
So when you practice, if you can just drop everything, then it's open, spacious, easy, even. You have the discipline. You sit up straight, you drop everything, your mind drops in a little discipline, and then it's just easy, open, spacious. And you may think there's an old saying that the Dharma is easy, but the Lama gives you a really hard time. So you may think, what is this old man telling me?
He's saying, I'd like to come back and wash my TV. And now that bad Lama said, don't watch that, and you know, don't talk on your phone. That bad Lama is giving me a really hard time.
Yeah.
I want to be happy, but the Lama is giving me a tough time.
So don't do this, don't do that, don't do this. You might get it, you might even be angry at him for pushing you like this, but you need to think about why Rinpoche is saying it. Rinpoche says that you need to think about why he's saying this. If you think carefully, then now you've had these extraordinary teachings. You have a chance to make your life meaningful. If you waste your life, the teachings are useless. But if you really put it just a little bit of effort, then this life can really become meaningful.
And Rinpoche is also saying that from his own personal experience during the years of retreat, that you know, while you're doing sitting practice, you should sit straight. And there's really great benefit just sitting in the right posture. It will bring forth your meditation. While if you do like this, you know, putting a hat and going like this and going like that and bending, one might just fart, you know, not have any particular. So therefore, it's very important to sit in the right posture and brings your awareness.
Dawa
Rinpoche is saying that when we initially, when we start meditation early in the morning, it may be tough for like a 1 month. You know, you have to get in the morning, like let's suppose 4 o'clock or 5 in the morning. You may not get, you find some difficulties, but then after you get used to that, after 1 month, then you get used to the second month, then third month, then it keeps going. That good habit will continue for the rest of your life because you will experience, you know, why that getting early in the morning and doing practice is so important. Is the time when Buddha, historical Buddha, got enlightened early in the morning. So therefore, the minds get very clear, and you can experience that benefit of that. Otherwise, the bad habit, you know, we just kind of delay, then, you know, the bad habits continues and your whole life will go like that. So therefore it's important to bring changes and get into right kind of habit instead of the bad habits. And of course we always can make time. It's not that we don't have time. There are people, some practitioner, then particular one person who has like 4 or 5 kids and he lives in America, you know, and he has to work and look up the children. At the same time, he finds 2-3 hours of practice every day. So it's not a question that we don't have time. We can make time, but we have to set the right kind of discipline to the timing, and it will continue that positive thing. And then once you've done your meditation practice in the morning, then afternoon you can do your work very relaxed. Of course, you can see the benefit, and it will continue like that.
Rinpoche said it's hard at first, but it's really nice. If you just tough it out for 1 or 2 or 3 months, that once you get used to it, you're going to feel so fresh and good. That's because it's such a, that's the choice time to practice, and you won't want to miss it.
She is saying that his teachers, all his teachers before him on the lineage masters, they were all incredible enlightened beings. And he said he's the worst among them. But one thing he feels so good about himself, that he have never degenerated his relationship with his teacher and the lineage. And it's a pure lineage, he holds it. You know, he never have an impure thought to his teacher and the lineage, always kept that sanctity in purity. So therefore he feels very good about that, to pass on that purity to you, to all of us here, so that you can continue the practice with the genuine tradition, and the, particularly the Dzogchen tradition teachings he's given. They are so profound that, you know, if you can practice it, you know, this lifetime, the earlier part of your life will be happier, the later part of your life will be even more happier, and the Bardo will be even more happier, and next lifetime you will have the freedom to choose where you want to be. So therefore, please practice and make endeavor, and so that you don't, you know, like a precious jewel, you don't throw it away, but, you know, this whole, so therefore how to do that, like earlier Rinpoche was saying, how we should do, was looking at one's fault, then, you know, the devotion and the practice of meditation. So,
and there was an example Rinpoche gave at the end. Even there's been darkness for thousands of years, but as soon as there's light, in an instant, it's cleared away. And so these teachings are so profound, and it, particularly Rinpoche, he's shared the teachings with you, and he's shared the power of his lineage with you. You have this tremendous opportunity. If you can just sustain the actual state, if you can just sustain the Buddha nature for an instant, it's like that light turning on and clearing away thousands of years of darkness in an instant. Doesn't matter how long the darkness was there. So that just an instant of recognizing your Buddha nature, it clears away so much negative karma, so much obscuration. That is the power of this practice. These profound instructions that he has offered to you. And so when you think about that, it would be such a tragedy not to put it into practice.
So now we're going to do some meditation practice. Everyone should sit straight. If you want to, if you sit in a chair, it's fine, or sit on the ground, but sit straight. And I've remembered the end, but not the middle. So, yes. Right, and so, of course, if you want to lie down or rest or sort of, you have whatever posture you kind of want to use to meditate, so if you, one can do that if one's really recognized your Buddha nature. For someone who's recognized the Buddha nature, then whatever you do is okay.
I think this is what Rinpoche is saying is really very profound, because what he's saying, you know, he's kind of bringing a profound teaching with a sense of humor. And what he was saying that, you know, one has to sit in the right posture, but if you like to lie down, it's up to you. But he said, you know, because due to our afflictive emotion and obscuration, we couldn't see our basic goodness, the Buddha nature within us. But if one did, if one is awakened into that awareness, then it really doesn't matter. Even you're sleeping, the basic goodness is always basic goodness, or the Buddha nature is always Buddha nature. It is never compromised. So you're able to experience that. You can lie down, you can sit, it's always there. But until one achieves that level, one needs the right posture. And so now we will sit, Rinpoche said. So what we're going to say, I'm going to sit now. I'm not going to be a slave of my conceptual thought. So my conceptual thought is a warning to you. I'm not going to be your slave. Neither am I going to be
abiding.
Abiding. Neither I'm going to be,
pushing.
So I'm going to move you abiding or the grasping or kind of like grasping or attachment, in other words, to a calmness of meditation, like in Shamatha, there is like you feel very calm and you attach to that. So it says, one who is attached to this stillness or to the calm, you just move a little away. And also the movement and conceptual thoughts which arises, you also the movement of my mind move a little bit aside. In between that gap to the awareness, I'm going to. So can you go ahead and explain a little bit from your translation?
So this was when Rinpoche was going like this and this. He said, Necha, the aspect, literally means the aspect of abiding, or as Rinpoche said, the stillness.
Which is linked with attachment, right?
You can say shamatha, but in the Dzogchen tradition, we say the aspect of abiding. And so Rinpoche was saying, okay.
In other words, it's like, excuse me, attachment.
Yeah.
Excuse me, movement. I'm going to be for a moment.
Don't
cloud me. Please forgive me. Excuse me for the moment. I need to see my awareness.
Now meditate.
So I will give you this sign.
Your
body needs to be straight. Which said, relax, straight, and relax.
Rinpoche
said in meditation, very important, you should not hang on tightly, do not be uptight. Always there is a sense, oh, now I have to do meditation, I have to be very proper. So we bring extra kind of weight, extra uptightness. That should never be the case. One should be like normal how you are, but not getting distracted. The normal sense of your day-to-day life, how relaxed you are. Be in that state, but without distraction. That is important. If you try to be so uptight, then almost like one body get like, you know, your eyes gonna pop out, or you know, or the blood is gonna bleed through your face. So it shouldn't be like that. Total ease.
And Rinpoche was saying, even we think we're not making, Timshaw, you can say uptight, but you can also say making effort. Even if we think we're not making effort, we are making effort at the beginning. And so we need to just really let it go.
Yeah, drop that.
Drop it.
Yeah. At the beginning, when one is meditating, one needs to learn how to have total ease, you know, because that lot of strenuous effort and uptightness, it is not the right thing. But then, if one gets a little distracted, then you kind of focus to that. But basically, you're like your daily how you are. On top of that, just you know, without being distracted. Leave the same ease, be in the same ease.
What do you mean?
If you have any questions, yes.
We meet here how many times a week? We have Thursday sitting practice, and then Sunday also we are meeting? Sunday morning. Sunday. And then what other day?
That's it right now.
So Thursday and Sunday. Zapurbu Gunda, Chusu Duna Chekane, Guba Perduor, Long Gunda, Gumgap Tamji Drolinji. Any Zanima Shoki Chusu Chubane, Chungi Perdu, Su Gumgabayona, which was
down. What ain't he would do? Chunzukan of the Miami.
Mexique chuna sa pasangunda pemba ningang nima ningang yang tiang yori
rembuji shugdu rembuji na gida
lari
rembuji midi ko paramba ju chi gana
yabuya rembuji is asking me, you know, what is our program here at the center, and I explained rembuji we have Thursday evening meditation from 7 to 9 and then Sunday morning is open from 10 to 12. And also when I'm here, when I give like a weekend teachings sometimes, there are different teachings. But of course, right now we just opened it. It's been fairly new center. And Rinpoche say that, and of course this fall we have the program of drama practice from Lama Yunten. And Lama Yunten is a qualified Lama who has done his traditional teaching on the drama practice completely, completed, and he's qualified to teach. And so it'll be wonderful that you this year teach drama teaching and practices how to do, Rinpoche is saying. And that will be wonderful. And also on meditation, Rinpoche is asking Brendan if you can sometime come and please give some teaching. That will be wonderful to people, can beneficial. So both of you, please, Rinpoche is saying, one to do the trauma teaching, one to do meditation teaching, will be wonderful and great.
Trees,
And he's been mentioning, you know, of course, while I'm here, I will be the I will be giving the teaching. But when I'm not here, and the Lama Yunten and Brendan can come and help, you know, for the Sangha to give teaching, so it'll be really wonderful. And then we need to get used to our practice and clarify those things. Otherwise, last year also I did it, previous year also I did that. There's no improvement, you know, when you don't have a, you know, either your own practice or guidance, then there will be no improvement. So those improvements has to come one by through one's own practice and also help from the teachers how to clarify those mistakes and then to work from that.
Yeah.
So Rinpoche is saying, if you get, as you get more and more familiar with the practice, it becomes easier and easier to do, it's such a tremendous, precious opportunity. We've received these teachings. Then, in difficult times like this, it's so rare, even more rare, to think about it. One really should put it into practice. And you know, it was said in the Dzogchen teachings, when the Lama, you have a Lama who's fully qualified, and a teaching that's fully endowed, and then a student with complete devotion. And when those three come together, then it can really work. And indeed, not even in your entire lifetime, but even just in years and months, one can make tremendous progress in the practice. It's possible. And in these teachings, it doesn't matter whether you're a woman or a man, old or young. None of these distinctions matter at all. If one practices, all of you can actually do it. And how extraordinary to really taste your Buddha nature and bring it out and actualize that in this lifetime. It's something all of you can really do if you make some effort at it. Of course, you have to make some effort, but as you do it, it gets easier and easier and more wonderful.
So cheshu gangbu tamzi zangma. Ta be zogwa shimbi chuyo gangwa lo chiro gyangriwa. Chichiro gyangri jik gangwa lo kongru mesa ta meri di su nyomo tamzi li hiwe she du cho chik yore. Chabzo kongru yuwa re di ti gangwa lo changma lo kongru lamsang shi ne jik tinda mi chige lo be yagwa lo be tamzi zangwa chik yu di kaya shimbari. Teni lama li taba dan zunru chik yu di kaya shimbari. O tingi yin chung ten diwari.
So it's very important to keep pure samaya, to keep a really pure, positive relationship, not just with the teacher, but it's also very important amongst all of the Dharma brothers and sisters, all of you who receive these profound teachings together. Then, of course, we're all human beings, and sometimes we get angry, we brush up against each other.
People get emotion, what you're saying.
Yeah. And so, but when that happens, and your anger arises, then let go of it right away. Don't hold on to it. And that's really important. Don't hold on to your anger. And so keeping good samaya is really important. and then a devotion to the teacher is very important, and effort, Tsondru, saying those three, samaya, devotion, and effort.
So what's the question?
Thank you, Rinpoche. My question is that it seems that I've been breathing incorrectly all my life, and I heard during these teachings that I need to be breathing through meditation through my mouth completely, mostly, and I find myself in meditation now thinking mostly about how am I breathing. And please explain to me how important it is that I do retrain myself to breathe through my mouth. If you know that's
it,
that is the case.
Frankie, then the Bordukim, that Kasim Muchik, Ukanetangu, then the Bordukim, Missy Gampung, Uk Nornetang, Jas. That is a tango, Kurampata, Kunsushine, Gum to make Nagune Chitango. Now, Tin Tita, Petangi, Missy Gampung, Uk Norning, Tangituta, Kandis Uk Tango.
No, marry me. Zaman ini semacam kamu tu dah terus. Ini kamu nyamni situ dan lung di tu sen negu dan kan hara jadi lung di mahu ranglo tu patang yer. Ranglo tu mahu semacam nasi semyer. Tidak mari tak.
Rinpoche saying that don't worry, you haven't breathing right. You know, it's not that you have breathed wrongly in your life. You know, you're still here. You know. But what Rinpoche is saying that, you know, when you do meditation, you're supposed to breathe, you know, from your mouth, because when you breathe from your mouth, the wind reverses back into the into body. So what happens then, the mind gets in stillness, you know, it can easily get into the calm abiding state. So it's not raw, it's, you know, when you do meditation, then you have to do that way of breathing. But normally, you know, most people, we all breathe through the nose.
He was asking, you know, he's obsessed. He's making so much effort to breathe the right way and obsessing
right now. What to do about it? Then the number of the room which you to pay, Mississippi, Uzu, Shivu, and Bezu, Chigi, US. Rinpoche is saying that you don't have to worry, you know, all you just breathe it naturally from your mouth. You know, you don't have to make any effort or worry. You know, you're not a dead person, you know. So you still breathe naturally from your mouth, and then that's it. There's no need to do more than that. The wind, the air, the breathing, the air reverses back when you breathe from your mouth, and that's very important for the practice of meditation.
Then can I go pay your money?
And there's no difficulty at all in that.
Then you can go to Shibuduna. Then my Timmy shooks his husband there, sit down and think who answered to me.
Then, even if you still have difficulty, you know, then just make a big fart and you will feel really comfortable.
Rinpoche
said in Tibet, if people fart a little bit, it's very shame. People get very shy, embarrassed. But this is a free country, so people feel very relaxed. There's no embarrassment.
Hansi Barani Ban.
Love me. There was a long time ago, there was this Australian guy who was Rinpoche's student, and he would fart so much, and all the nuns get so shy, they run away. It's just one's custom.
Rinpoche, thank you for your teaching. I have a question. After we recognize the Buddha nature, it's very easy to lose it. So what's the best way to sustain it, maintain it, and lengthen it?
Tene ta simge nilu te kurang padu skom gyabintu gyopa la drugudus nilu ke ngadu nema du la drugudus te la medu eche tu gyun kyanye te la tene khani chibore ishu la
drugudus
ta pe ye drugudus ta sim yeng drugudus la ta wik pagi rikme ngadu nema du bai yeng drugudus
te kami ru kanyi gyua muda memin sabat lenge me chikin yomong tuwa tila gyua nchiribu komdo chimura wa ti kamir tangu ti meyeng che duga gomja guyar gomja jidin kali kali la kor neza ti la pa kali la sim di ne wasana sim di tangu di bengazu kangu lo gomja du jana kinyo man ne shi jan but renjung long jung je tang yu man ji du yar wa jinye di kamir ko gyon sir wa ti la shine ra korang la kali la neza da na kali kali la chegum chegum chine tene pa duk dunga di pa chiten de ruri kali kali na ru yuma na tangu di lamsang yung yuma ri kamir.
Rinpoche is saying that it's not going to happen immediately because due to so many karmas and habits from so many lifetimes, so they're all like kind of obscuring the one's awareness. But gradually, if you keep continuing through the shamatha meditation, for example, on the stillness and calm abiding, then gradually the awareness will shine over the time. And of course, we are doing meditation so that we can have that stability within us. Otherwise, there's no point of doing meditation. And that's why we are doing meditation, so we can achieve that realization, awaken over the time, step by step, gradually it will happen. And if you still have problem, your mind is getting distracted from the view, then you can visualize to some letter R, like in the script letter R in front of the space, or you can, you know, have it written and focus to your mind to that. So there are different ways of concentrating your mind. For example, pure concentration and impure concentration. Pure concentration is such as focusing on Buddha's body, body, speech, and mind. Or like impure, like focusing your mind to some object of any ordinary object, such as a stick or flower, whatever. So you can focus to that. And then gradually your mind gets into stability. And then you can, you know, kind of like conquer your mind. So you have to do it in those methods.
But Rinpoche was saying, you know, there's so many methods. You can just make it simple and visualize the white ah in space in front.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're doing And so you can. Now, so this meditation on visualizing the white ah in the space in front of you, at first you let it be a little bit larger so it's comfortable and easy to see it. And then as you get used to the meditation and that gets very stable, then you make it smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until it's just so tiny, like just the breadth of a hair. And then finally, it dissolves away and there's nothing there, but you still can maintain that stability.
So there's two part. One is the stability part, then it's like into kama abiding, and the emptiness part. So one is shamatha and one is vipassana. You can achieve those both states through that approach of meditation.
And at the beginning of answering this question, you know, Rinpoche was saying, kayamare. He says, of course, you don't have to feel bad. It's natural that it's difficult to do this, and it takes time. And so it's okay to practice the shamatha. It's okay to, if you just flash a little bit of your Buddha nature, but then you keep falling down to shamatha.
No, he didn't say it okay to practice. He said, it's what you said, kayamare. It's okay because, how did you translate? You translate, kayamare.
You don't have to feel bad.
Yeah, you don't have to feel bad because all the habitual tendencies and obscuration from so many lifetimes, we're used to that. That's what is obscuring us. So therefore, one should do the shamatha meditation, stability, as you just mentioned right now. You know, which is saying that there's two aspects, kama abiding, and then its essence, which is emptiness. So kama abiding past the shamatha meditation, which will stabilize your mind, be in the stillness, mind is not distracted, not wavering, it's right there. Then seeing its empty nature, you see the vipassana aspect of meditation, the extraordinary insight of the view of the awareness.
That didn't remember.
No. So then, let's do world peace prayer. Yes? Yeah, go ahead. No, give to Deborah. So first.
It's kind of a big question.
Yeah.
Oh. All right. Well, first, Rinpoche, thank you so much for your teachings. I was so impacted by the 4 days of teaching, really broken open in a lot of ways. And so I guess my question is not to detract from the individual inner work, but to ask a bigger question. So the question is, Rinpoche, it seems to me that inside this teaching, there's a very profound and radical statement about human society and what's possible. And I'm wondering if there really is that aspiration in this teaching, or if it's really just a bigger version of hope and fear.
Courtesy.
Oh,
Tene kongi tene rimshi kati nane ne pemizi katen chembure tene kati di tene ina yang nge tiwa shuye di nangi nyamna ngi kor mares tene kongi manang nge tiwa shuye di
nangi nyamna nangi nyamna ngi kor la pemisi pinga tene nyama shi kati na tele pe kirwa chik tep sons chik morang broken to
catch it, so same catch it, but I
in Yipati society,
did a Yamion Chonson cutting chamber, Yina Yang, Dinajingi, Karsimi, vertical statements in a migi chiso, but in a petakaka de yong sigres.
Deborah, when you said that in the society radical, what is, can you just rephrase that question again?
So the question is, it seems to me that within the teaching, there was a very profound statement about what's possible for human society. And I wonder if that is an aspiration within the teaching, or if that's just more hope and fear.
When you talk about human society, which part you are referring to?
So I'm talking about a statement about a possibility for a different kind of society that's more gentle and heart-driven and enlightened with less suffering. Is that aspiration held in the teaching? Because it seems like there's a very profound statement about that possibility.
Tindi kuranga tsu munam tang en tindi chubgir ves ta chugi na na dile kurang pa tindi simni te kyang tu na en dungye tam je seba tam chi ji or ba tindi ta kuranga tsu gi sig na na tile chi so sipe na chi so tindi chi yong tu gir ves simje tam chi mi ro tam chi dewe nga na ne tu ba chi dungye nyang me go tindi chi yong tu gir ves tinga tsu munam shu gu go ba
yang na pe karisne richard mixer gi ti gi yang na dida samlo monam gachem wodane redok samre be syang
nganzu ngune chungre be
ngat nungne ke kachemare di nganzu redokin si samgore be nyamne nguni chegine yang dida tukye monam dabu yine nganzu nyamne nyamdu drogire be
kundis the hak mas
kundis
karisene nganzu
mutish shem bata da chiso na ni yores chiso chikte ta nam yu sim jen tam je ki le da nyung bi ji so ji dung ying yok ta mang bu ji or ta de lin ru mu chi ke ti no tu pe me si bi ding ni ya ko ra pa ting sa bu ji ini sim jen tam ji dung ye tam ji je ba ini ko ra pa de beng na ne tu we ji ti mo nam ji re be ti de ni yong tu gi re be si ju yin ba da
yong tu gi re be
de ni ka ri shu
the is there a conflict between having that kind of aspiration and this giving up of hope and fear, is that your
ta conflict zitu rimbachi ta cho chikni kurang pa ting zapu tindi yo ba chik che cho chini ta nyumung tungi kurang ta rimbachi pe tsing yo yo arba rimbachi ti nyi cha ka monam tabtu ta karishu bar
chitang gi pene nganzu zemling chitar gi chiso gi monam gachi mo chi gyo gi yudda yo chu gi nangla yine kepar nganzu zopu chenpo gi kati nangla redo pura pangos chik sungi dwa di chen redo pura pango na yang anju di najin gi chiso gi tukye monam dini di nyamdu kandi drogi nyamdu drogi duges nganzu di najin gi nyam gi nanglo gi nyamnen zaba chi kyon na di chiso gi pende gi monam gachi mo nyamdu drogi duges
da zoshin nangla redo pangsung arba tam monam kevete rewa chigruwa ta tini kandi rewe chiyo
monam kemni lhada lama suwa dasu na lhada lama suwa dami miruwa meruwa kungu lakuzo rewa lhada lama suwa di vidi kipa rangi semla be nyamung tungwa di shiwa shu simja tamja linge pamba shu monam yajin kebun
Rinpoche is saying that there's two parts. One part is one's meditation on emptiness, on ultimate reality, which is beyond hope and fear. And then when you bring aspiration, there is hope. And that's where you find the conflict, right? And so Rinpoche is saying that when you gain the inner experience, then the conflict begin to cease. And when there is conflict begin to cease, then naturally your aspiration for contribution to the society is fulfilled. As the is like the, either you use side effect or the direct impact of your finding. For example, he was also saying that looking at one's own fault, only then once your afflictive emotions and negativities and neurosis goes down, then there is, you know, peace in you, and that is the aspiration, natural aspiration, which can contribute for the peace of the society. We can achieve that. But as long as we don't look at one's fault, there is so much, even we want to bring contribution, there is no way, because our conflict and our aggression, everything is still there. So the peace is not a possible in that way.
And this is very mundane, but he said, if this helps, just from the point of view of your practice, Rinpoche was saying, of course, you pray to the Lama and you pray for peace in the world and happiness and all sentient beings being freed from their suffering. You make that aspiration. Yes, that's hope and fear. You do that. And then you just drop it and do your practice. And then you make an aspiration and you drop it and then you do your practice. And as Rinpoche said, then it works itself out that way.
Because aspirations, also making aspirations are very powerful because of the enlightened activity, power of that Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, that will also become true. Yeah. But fundamentally, working within oneself, once our turmoil, inner turmoil is reduced or dissolved, then naturally the expression is peace, aspiration that one is making for the peace. That will manifest naturally.
That is.
Okay. So world peace prayer now.
So Rinpoche is saying it's just been an extraordinarily fortunate time for everyone to come together in this way. And it's the result of positive karma and aspirations of all of us for so many lifetimes, but especially of Chögyal Rinpoche's aspiration and merit to manifest all of this for all of us. So Rinpoche is really so happy with what's with the retreat and the teachings and with all of you having practiced, having received the teachings, and now you really need to abandon distractions and practice. And at, right now, you're still at the stage where you think all of these distractions and things outside you are interesting. But once you really taste the practice, the tenmo means, you know, an entertainment. You're attracted to all the entertainment outside. He says, once you just begin to taste the practice, all the entertainment's on the inside. Just a little bit of shamatha, and you're going to taste bliss.
The entertainment will manifest.
Yeah, and Rinpoche said, you know, just a little bit of shamatha, and then the experiences of bliss, clairvoyance, non-thought, you won't have any interest in the TV and the internet. So please, do like that, and then all of these aspirations, merit, will come to fruit. And Rinpoche says from his side, he's going to pray for all of you. He's going to pray that your practice comes well.
In the world in general
and in this nation, may not even the names disease, famine, war, and suffering be heard. May virtuous qualities, merit, and prosperity greatly increase. And may continuous good fortune and sublime well-being perfectly arrive. In the world in general, in this nation, may not even the names disease, famine, war, and suffering be heard. May virtuous qualities, merit, and prosperity greatly increase. And may continuous good fortune and sublime well-being perfectly arise. In the world in general, and in this nation, may not even the names disease, famine, war, and suffering be heard. May virtuous qualities, merit, and prosperity greatly increase. And may continuous good fortune and sublime well-being perfectly arise.
By this merit,
may all beings gain omniscience. May they defeat the enemy. From the turbulent waves of birth, old age, sickness, and death, from the ocean of becoming, may all beings be liberated.
Also, thank you very much for all. And I just want to mention, yesterday morning, you know, I've missed few names, those who've been kind. So one is Deborah. Who's been very kind here, generous, and really worked so hard for the center here. I'd like to thank her. Deborah, please come forward. Yeah.
Thank you.
She put a lot of help and generosity. I really thank her and everybody else who put so much time and effort to the center. Thank you very much. And let's all pray that Rinpoche comes back again and again, and he lives a long life, and so wonderful. Thank you.
I think Deborah and Tracy had something to say.
What, to Rinpoche? Yeah, sure.
So it's with a lot of love that we have two more little gifts to give. Actually three, but two. We want to say thank you from all of the volunteers. Actually, there was an effort to say thank you to the three people who have been taking care of us as we help for so long as we've put this all together. So we would like to call Tara and Genevieve, and I know Jim's not here, but if Genevieve and Tara could come up to accept just a little offering from us. I know Genevieve and Jim in particular have taken care of us so much that this is just a little offering to help them take care of themselves as well.
Also here we have Matt here, who has been here all the time helping so much, and I really appreciate all your hard and kind work and love. Genevieve, please bring me a mala, a crystal mala, show his purity. So Matt, please come forward. Offer, you know, Rinpoche can give from his hand.
blessing that has to be done.
Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara.
So thank you so much, everybody. This has been the experience of a lifetime, and I just feel all warm and fuzzy inside for everything everyone's given to this. It's just amazing, the community and the interdependence, the connectedness that's made all of this possible. So thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. And I know Jim feels the same. He's watching from afar, from Boulder right now. So thank you, everybody. And there is one more event Wednesday. It's just going to be a Vajrasattva blessing ceremony. And Rinpoche is going to kind of bless the center. He's going to consecrate statues. And if you have any items to bring, he'll actually bless malas and bells and the whole thing, you know, whatever.
Yes.
Okay. There you go. And great, yeah. And everyone needs to label their items because this has the potential to be a big mess. So please help us as much as you can. Keep track of it. Label your stuff. Get it at the end of the ceremony when it's all blessed and finished. The ceremony, we don't know quite how long it will go. Maybe all day and end at four. No. Okay.
It starts. It starts at 9, I suspect will end by roughly 1-ish, give or take. Yes, you can. Any statues that have been blessed by previously by another Lama can be blessed, but statues have to have been previously consecrated, previously filled with the appropriate mantras and substances. So we have a bunch of new statues that have been newly filled, including the statues in the center and the Dharmapala statue that actually have had a consecration, but not from someone like Soktse Rinpoche. So we're doing those again. And some statues that have never been consecrated, we're doing. And if you have statues on your shrine that have been filled with mantras by another Lama and consecrated, yes, you can. But if you just have an empty statue, that doesn't work. So just, you know, a statue without mantra. If it's a statue that has no hollow cavity,
Yes, like a wooden or a solid plastic, stone, that kind of statue. Those can be at the ceremony, but something that's hollow, it cannot be consecrated on Wednesday. And if all goes well, we'll be done by 1 o'clock, give or take. Yeah, if we're starting at 9, Jen, so you have to have it here at least an hour early. And if you bring things in a container, like a plastic bag, a box, please be efficient with space. If there's a lot of stuff, it's going to be mayhem. And it has to be here at least an hour early. We're also going to need people to help set up Tuesday afternoon or evening, and Tuesday evening might be a better time, actually.
Yeah. So I'm planning to be here at the center tomorrow starting at noon at the latest. So as much help as we can get. We might need errands run to pick up stuff, just cleaning, setting up for the ceremony. I don't even know exactly what it's going to entail, but I know it's going to be quite a lot. So starting at noon, I can probably use all the help that I can get. And so you can bring in your items anytime after noon, because we'll be here getting stuff ready. All right. All right, and oh, someone lost a hand beaded necklace. What color is it? So if anyone, yeah, okay. I think that's it.